What is going on, man?
There he is.
What's up, dude?
Well, you passed the pre-interview. Now here's the real deal.
Yeah, right. That was just the preliminary exam to make sure I was up for the challenge.
Yeah, that was the PSATs. Now this is the real shit.
Oh, shit, man. I never took the real shit, so...
Dude, it pissed me off so fucking much because, like, I did the intro and everything. I'm like, okay, wow, it went great, whatever. You know, we went like an hour 19 or something like that. It's like, cool. It didn't even bother going back and checking it. So yesterday I talked with Kevin, the lead singer of It Lives, It Breeds. And then, like, we talked for like 54 minutes. And then I went back and checked. I was like, yeah, let's see how it came out. And I heard nothing. I was like, oh, no. Oh, no. I was like, well, at least I have Thursday's episode. Clicked on your episode. Nothing. I was like, oh, well, fuck me, right?
Oh, fuck. Yeah, dude, that sucks really, really bad. I hate technical difficulties.
Oh, dude. My God, I was like Joe Pesci in every one of his movies. I was like, you motherfucking shit. I said every curse word underneath, you know, I could think of at that moment.
Dude, I've totally had a whole lot of... A whole lot of moments like that with recording and stuff like that. Just it'll randomly crash sometimes, like if I'm trying to do too much at once.
Yeah.
But honestly, I'm not operating on some sort of like crazy, like home built PC or some shit.
Yeah.
I'm doing a MacBook, so you know that can only really hold so much.
Yeah, but holy shit.
But at least we're able to make it work.
Yeah, dude, I can't thank you enough for this.
Oh, no worries, man. I was just sitting around not doing anything, man. Yesterday, went and saw Born of Osiris, and I was super sick.
Nice, but man.
Today, I mean, just hanging out, you know? So I'm here for this.
Hell yes. You cleared your entire schedule for May, and that's awesome.
Yeah, I don't have anything going on, so let's do it.
Hell yeah. Oh, shit. So... My God, what the hell did we talk about on the Thursday interview besides everything under the sun?
Oh man, we were all over the place. To be honest with you, I don't even remember a ton of it. I remember we talked about how much I hate needles. I hate going to the doctor.
Yep, needles sucks.
Those kids. I guess we could talk about weird things. I don't know, man. I did weird shit as a kid. I don't know. I feel like everyone did some weird shit at some point. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, of course.
I don't know. I think kids are just fucking goofy.
I think kids have gotten even worse nowadays.
Yeah, dude. I'm not even entirely sure. I'll tell you, my only current experience with the way like kids are like nowadays is I live in a apartment complex, and I live on the first floor, and the stairs to get to the second floor are right by like my door to get onto my porch.
Gotcha.
And for whatever reason, those stairs are like, that's the hangout spot for all the kids in the apartment complex.
Huh.
So pretty much every day from like 3:30 in the afternoon to like 8 o'clock at night, like Monday through Friday, on Saturday and Sunday, it's literally all day from when I wake up. They're sitting on those fucking stairs listening to like 21 Savage and like Lil Uzi, and like, I'm like, what is going on, dude? Like they're like 10, they're like 8, 9, 10 years old. Like, there's one kid that looks like he's probably like as young as 5.
Oh my God.
I'm like, why the hell are you guys listening to this shit out here? But it's funny because one of the kids in the group, like you can tell he's like the one that doesn't like that kind of music. Because like literally I've seen him wearing a Secrets shirt before. I've seen him wearing Asking Alexandria before. But he's the only one that wears anything like that. So I'm like, oh, that poor kid. Oh man, I know how you feel, dude. You're just like, I'm the only one that likes metal in here.
Dude, does he realize who's living right next to those stairs?
Dude, it's actually really funny because I considered like bringing it up to him one time because he was wearing a secret shirt and we were going to be playing with Secrets and Siler and Ice Nine Kills.
Oh, wow, yeah.
And so I wanted to like you know, go up to him and be like, hey man, like, do you want to go to this? But believe it or not, I got too scared. I actually, like, there was several opportunities, but I let anxiety get the best of me, and I was like, nah, that's gonna be weird. That kid's gonna think it's weird. So
well,
I just,
it's not like you're inviting him to go with you. I mean, if you do that, that's kind of weird. It's like, hey, you're 10 years old. I'm in my 20s. You wanna hang out? Now that's fucking weird. But you know,
well, also this kid is he's like on the older end of the. I should probably have mentioned that on the other end of the group. He's probably like 15 or 16.
Okay,
so he's probably way more like the age range that would actually like go to that show and like be interested in going to a show. I'll probably bring it up at some point. I get social anxiety when dealing with groups of kids, apparently, because I can't even figure out how to tell them like be quiet when I'm trying to sleep. So I just kind of let them scream all day long.
Yeah, that's never going to end well, because you don't want to be like that grouchy neighbor. Oh yeah, it's don't go near Mr. Browder's place. Oh God.
Yeah, right. And if I'm sitting around here like smoking and stuff like that, I feel like at some point they smell it.
Oh, absolutely.
And so it's like, yeah, you know what? We'll cut each other some slack. Like, I don't get mad at you. You don't say anything about this. We'll all be fine.
You have an understanding.
Exactly. It's like a mutual respect.
There you go. It's like, you ever watch Seinfeld?
I have.
Yeah, it's like the episode with George and the pigeons. We got a deal, Jerry. We got a deal.
Dude, I don't know that I've seen that episode. I haven't watched a ton of Seinfeld. My girlfriend brought up watching it, and so we're probably – that'll be the next thing. We're watching Bates Motel right now. I know this is
completely different. I hear that's a great show.
Dude, it's wild. It's, like, really hard to not watch, like, when – we're not hanging out together, because like it's one of those things like where we're wanting to watch it together.
Yeah.
So we, you know, I can't watch it when she's gone, but I really want to.
Well, that's good. I mean, you at least have that mutual thing in that relationship. You're like, all right, look, you know, as much as I like this, I love you more. I'm going to wait for you instead of, yeah, I'm on season 7. You're on season 1. What the fuck's wrong with you? Let's go.
Yeah, I have been really bad about that in the past with shows, so I'm trying not to be that way with this one. Dude, it's just like with Netflix and Hulu and all that shit, man. It's just so easy. It's so easy to listen or to watch whatever you want, you know, constantly.
Yeah. And the worst part about it is like with Netflix, where it's like 5 seconds to the next episode. It's like, yeah, I know you want to sit here and watch. Come on, just stay one more episode. That's all. It's like a drug dealer basically shooting you up with heroin. And you're like, yeah, stay on the couch. It's fine. It's fine. I'm just going to put this on for you. And you know what? Here comes another one and another one. And just to make sure you're still paying attention and still awake, I'm going to come up with something on the screen that makes you hit okay. And you're going to watch like 9 episodes, miss, you know, living your life outside.
Yeah, that's kind of what it's become for me. I watch a lot of, I watch a lot of Netflix originals, man. Nice. Netflix does a fantastic job of having original shows.
Nice. Which one do you watch?
I watch, what is that one called? Peaky Blinders. Really good. What else have I been watching? Oh, I watched, let me pull it up really quick, because I really want to give a plug to this, because this is a good movie.
Go for it.
Let's see. It should be, like, literally just on, because I had Netflix pulled up, honestly, before you called, so, I mean, I should just be able to pop it right back up.
Oh, okay.
But, I don't know. I'll figure it out. I'm going to figure it out. I'll bring it up. But, anyway, yeah, man, there's just a ton of really great, great stuff, you know?
Yeah.
It should be kind of interesting to see, like, where the industry goes, like, as far as, like, actual television.
Mm-hmm.
Because I would wonder how many people actually still watch it, you know?
Yeah, it's kind of odd because, you know, me, myself, I wait until basically even a series is over before I start watching it, or at least like a season into it. I'd be like, okay, it's time to catch up. And, you know, it's not like the 90s where it's like if you miss it, you're kind of screwed. You know, nowadays it's like, all right, you know, if I'm really, really, really want to watch it, there's DVR. There's like different websites out there. There's torrents I could download. You know, it's out there. So, I don't know. But I think television is going to remain the same, but they have to do something with cursing. If you look at, you know, FX did a wonderful job. I don't know if you watch It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, but they just had a recent episode where they dropped the F-bomb. And I was like, holy shit. Oh, yeah, wait a second. You can do that on cable. Like, everyone keeps forgetting that anyone can say anything on cable. It's just the network shows you can't. And the reason why they don't say anything on basic cable is because of advertisements. Because I don't think any advertiser wants to work with a show that says cunt about 40 times. But you never know.
It's yeah, weird. And that's the unfortunate truth of the matter, because the average person, I feel like cusses. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like I know more people that do than don't.
Yeah.
So it's like, why are we like keeping this whole thing so like hush hush?
Yeah, it's weird. It's like, what are you shielding us from? Yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense to me. Let me see here. Oh, here it is. Okay, yeah. So that the name of that movie is called "I Don't Feel at Home in This World Anymore."
Oh shit, that's the one with
Elijah Wood.
Yes.
Yeah, dude. That's why I watched it, because I like Elijah Wood. So I was like, dude, I'll check this out. You know, it seems kind of interesting. And it was a super weird movie, but I liked it because it was so weird.
Yeah, I heard an interview that he was on. He was like talking about it. I was like, wow, this sounds really out there. And then he's like, yeah, we won the Sundance, I guess the whatever the top film award for Sundance is. I think they won it. So I was like, wow, that's pretty fucking cool.
Yeah, dude. It was a good movie. Another weird one. Have you ever seen that movie, It's Such a Beautiful Day?
Who's in it?
Okay, so it's like it's like a drawing thing. It's like a cartoon type thing.
Uh-huh.
But it's mostly stick figure. And it's like an hour and a half film, and basically it's super dark humor. Like, it's one of those things where it's like they get so, it's so absurdly dark that you laugh about it eventually. Like, it's, you're following like this one guy along, and he's going through like hell essentially. Like, he gets fired, and then like he gets like diagnosed with cancer, and then they say that he's gonna die. But then, so like everybody, all of his family shows up because they think it's like his last week to live, and then it's like a miracle and he's gonna stay alive. So his whole family just leaves him and is like all annoyed that he didn't die. Like, they were mad that they took time off from work and stuff. And it was just really funny because it progressively gets like more fucked up, like to the point where like you're just sitting there like, Jesus fucking Christ, like, how can you think of anything like worse? Like,
yeah, really.
It's awesome though. Like, I really enjoyed it personally. Damn. That's my sense of humor though.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
You're just laughing about like absurdities.
Well, I mean, you're supposed to laugh at them. I mean, as dark and twisted as it sounds, I mean, that's the best way to go through it, is just to make light of certain situations.
Yeah, I think a lot of people forget about that, like when it comes to comedy.
Yeah.
And people talk about like there's certain things you shouldn't talk about. I don't think that's necessarily true. I think you should be able to talk about whatever you feel like talking about, but you have to understand how to go about it and use it in the correct context. Exactly. You know what I mean? Like, make jokes that are going to be appropriate jokes. Especially if they're going to be, like, kind of, you know, edgy.
Yeah.
You know, like, to me, there's, like, edgy jokes, and then there's just, like, a dude just being, like, really offensive and thinking it's funny. Like, I don't know. To me, there's, like, a line. But, I don't know. I don't really care. People can say whatever the fuck they want. Because at the end of the day, if I'm offended, like, who cares? Like, really, like, what does it matter who's offended by what, really? Like, that's just their opinion. They'll get over it. They'll probably forget about it by, like, tomorrow. Like, most of these kids that get offended on the internet are, like, offended by a new thing in the next 5 minutes anyway.
Yeah, really. I think it's every 3 days there's something new. And, like, if a company or something like that does, or a person does something insensitive, if they hold out, like, 3 days without, like, apologizing or anything, they just move on. It's the oddest thing in the world. And it actually happened to a close friend of mine. He was involved with something that wasn't even that bad. Yet, you know, he was a very popular writer on the internet. And without giving too much away, this girl basically called him out for sending dick pics. And, you know, what he told me was that it was a mutual thing. Like, he had pictures of her, but he wouldn't take the low ground with it, and then ended up apologizing and lost everything. So, I mean, thankfully he's back on his feet right now with, like, another company and stuff like that, but, I mean, there's sometimes where, as bad as it sounds, you gotta take the low road on things if it means, like, your career, if it means your well-being, you know, your family, your friends, stuff like that. You know, you can't just let some random person on the internet just go, well, you know what, fuck this guy, I want to make sure his career is over because of something, you know, I don't like. And, you know, if they were unwarranted dick pics, I get it. You know, she has every right in the world. But if they're, like, mutual, it's kind of odd.
But yeah. I mean, the way I see it is don't set yourself up for any sort of situation like that.
Yeah.
And then it'll never happen. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, obviously, I'm a complete hypocrite. Because, you know, I've done stuff like that in the past. Like, not, like, gotten into, like trouble, but, like, you know, like, dating and stuff like that, like, sending each other pictures, like, that just goes on nowadays.
Yeah.
But I don't know, be careful who you're with, you know, like,
exactly.
Be careful who you pillow talk with, you know. you never know, man. People are crazy.
Yeah, really. So I gotta ask you a question. I'm getting text messages left and right. Now, did a girl named Angie Perez reach out to you?
I'm not sure. Like, reach out to me about what?
She's one of our interviewers, and she just texted me now. She's like, who's talking with Cam tonight? I was like, I am. Why? She goes, yeah, I've been sending him, like, messages about coming on the show, and he kept leaving me at red.
Hey, actually, you know what? I'm going to drop that at right now. So at you right now, I opened up the messages. We have a total of 4 messages.
Oh.
All right? I was the first one.
Yeah.
September 2nd.
Ooh.
Said, we just dropped a new song with AJ from Five from the Gods. Check it out. And it's a link. Yeah, I was spamming. I've got no shame. Because she said, sweet, I'll check it out. I said, then can you do me a favor and check this out? And then it was another thing. So yeah, I mean, it was mostly spam.
Gotcha.
But I don't see any of that nonsense.
Oh, shit. That's a straight call out right there. Oh, shit.
Hey, don't say I didn't want to be interviewed. This is fun.
See, we're bringing a live element to this, even though it's just me and you live right now. But
yeah, well, actually, I asked on, you know, Facebook what I should talk about or what I should bring up tonight.
I'm reading that right now.
So I got 3 comments: drugs, breakdowns, and the 420 festival. And what's funny is that could be like if you did drugs plus breakdowns equals the 420 festival, because that's what it is.
Yeah, more or less.
The 420 festival, it's a festival that I booked. It's obviously going to be on 420, but it's actually going to go all the way through to that Sunday, which is 423. There's like 50 bands total playing. It's at Tomcats in Fort Worth. I mean, I'll just say, because I mean, I got him confirmed, and pretty soon the flyer will come out anyway. But Kane Hill is going to be headlining.
Ooh.
That Friday night, and we'll be playing with them as well. So that's a little leak to keep this fresh and spicy here.
Absolutely.
I haven't said. I mean, people would obviously assume that I'm, you know, my own band would play a show that I booked that's that size, just because it would be fun, you know. Like,
yeah, absolutely.
If you can do it, why not?
And funny part about that comment that you did about the questions, Angie liked it. There we go. This is turning into like some real Inception shit.
This is like some this is some real shade, some real drama.
This is just hysterical.
This is we could turn this into Keemstar, dude.
Into what?
Have you ever seen Keemstar?
No, what the fuck is that?
Oh my god, don't even look it up, man. It'll just hurt your brain cells, man. He's a YouTuber, ?
Oh god.
And he's just like he used to do like the news, and what he would try to do is just be like pretty unbiased. Like at first it was like a good idea. Mm-hmm. And then he kind of like just turned it into like him talking about like drama. And so like he's just a real pain in the ass. Like he's annoying. But I mean, apparently he's seen the error of his ways and his new stuff's better. I don't know. I haven't checked it out. But so I apologize if he is actually better than he once was. But he used to literally just like, his YouTube videos would be like an hour and a half long, and it would just be him talking about fucking meaningless drama. Oh, I don't know, dude. He made so much money off of it. It blew my mind.
I still don't understand YouTubers. Like, I understand what they're doing. I just don't understand how fucking popular they are, especially PewDiePie. Like, all he's doing is playing a video game, doing dumb voices, and you're watching and listening to him do this. Now, back when I was a kid, if I wasn't playing the video game, I'd be pissed off. Like, I'm not going to sit there and watch someone else play a game that I want to play.
Yeah, I mean, I totally understand that. Me, personally, I watch stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I watch, like, I actually do watch PewDiePie. I watch H3H3. And I watch iDubbbz, and then I do watch some guys like Critical who play video games and stuff. And mostly, to me, what it is like I look at it as like the equivalent of like watching like sports on TV for people. Like, there's a lot of people that love watching sports on TV. I'm not one of them, but like I get it. Like, you like watching the sport, all of it happen. And to me, that's the same as like when I'm watching a video game, like being played on like a live stream or like a YouTube video. It's like, it's watching someone else's take on something that maybe I already do play. Like, a lot of times that is like, I've watched, you know, I beat Resident Evil 7 already, but I've watched Resident Evil 7 playthroughs just to kind of see like, you know, other people play it and their takes on it. Yeah. I don't know.
Like
that's what I'm into.
That sounds like a good idea if it was done by like the creators of the game. I think that would be extremely successful if the creators of Resident Evil 7 played the game and then showed you like little Easter eggs while they did that.
Yeah, that would be cool. I know that a lot of times these companies actually pay these YouTubers to play it. They'll like give them the game and give them like $5,000 and be like, hey, play the game on one of your videos.
Wow.
So in some cases, these dudes are in a way, they are with the game maker. Yeah. Because, you know, the game maker, you know, this, I was actually listening to a podcast yesterday that was talking about this and whether or not this like is like an integrity issue. But, some YouTubers are paid to write a good review for a game, to like have positive reactions while they're playing the game. So, you know, obviously then that kind of steps into like, is that okay, because like it's kind of like falsely promoting something. Like if you don't, like obviously you can do that, but like morally, are you okay with doing it? Like ethically, are you okay with basically lying to your audience and saying this is something I endorse and it isn't?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, the problem with that is everyone does it. So if you look at like a random CD review and, you know, let's say Motionless in White is coming out with a new album coming up. And, you know, people are just thinking, it's not really my cup of tea for whatever reason. And then you have Roadrunner Records reach out to a reputable magazine or like a brand like Rolling Stone or Alternative Press and be like, hey, listen, here's $5,000. Just say what you like about the album and maybe give it a 7 or 8 out of 10 because I know your audience will probably listen to it or and or buy the album, and by that time it's basically too late, we have their money. So I'm thinking a publication or, you know, a magazine like that would do that for a certain amount of money, and I'm sure they have done that before, you know, with like maybe some major label records or something like that, or like a Britney Spears record from back in the day or something like that. You know, it's been done. I know it's been done in movies all the time with reviewers and stuff like that. It's basically about power. And the more power someone has, the bigger the outreach is. So when companies see that, be like, oh, this guy has 5 or 10 million people listening to every word he's saying. We could definitely do this and have him do a review. We'll definitely get at least 1 million views on it. And out of that, maybe 500,000 listens off of that. Maybe 250,000 will buy the song. Maybe 125,000 will like it. And it just keeps trickling down to like a certain number. And once they hit the number, they'll be like, okay, you know what? This 5 grand or 10 grand I just paid, worth it. So in a sense, it's like evil marketing, but I understand why they do it on both sides.
Yeah. Yeah, I get it. But it's still... it's still like, I don't know. I don't feel like I could stand behind a product and say like, hey, buy this, if I didn't really feel like I wanted you to buy it. You know what I mean? Like as a musician, like, or as anybody that's like endorsing a product or reviewing a product, and that's their job to do that, you know, like, or you have any sort of voice, you know what I mean? I just think it's like, it's kind of, if you have a voice and like even, you know, a handful of people listen to your opinion, you should probably not, like, I don't know, just falsely endorse shit all the time. Because what's going to happen when like they try that shit out and then like they're like, this is garbage.
Yeah.
Like they see that like review that's like 9 out of 10 and they listen to it and they're like, what is this? Like, this is Audacity fucking recording, dude.
Yeah.
Like people will see through it most of the time. I think, at least.
Yeah, I could see that. But then again, you know, with my early days of watching wrestling, there was a character or a wrestler called the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase. And he had a saying that everyone has a price. And, you know, it kind of translated in life that if someone gave me a shitty product to promote and they paid me like a certain amount that I could be like, all right, you know what? I could say fuck you to my fan base right here. I would probably take it. I have no shame in doing that because I'd say 9 times out of 10 people would do that. Just because, you know, bills rack up higher. You know, if I have a fan base right now that's not paying me anything or not paying nearly as much as, you know, this company is going to give me, you know what? You could call me a sellout. You could call me whatever you want, but you're not paying my bills. You're not helping supporting me. There's an opportunity coming along. As shady and as shitty as it sounds, I'm going to do it. I'm going to take that. As long as it's not illegal, of course, but... You know, I'm not going to like peddle some drug out. Be like, yeah, this stuff makes you feel great. And next thing you know, there's like 12 deaths on my hand. I was like, no. But you know, if it's for, let's say, a guitar, and you know, the thing's basically falling apart, I might, like I said, the number would have to be really high for me to do it.
Well, I'm glad that the number would have to be high.
Yeah. So trust me, if you ever see me sponsoring a shitty product, just know I'm well paid.
Oh my god. I will. I'll make note of it.
There you go.
Oh, shit.
You right over there?
Yeah, sorry. I was just clearing my throat and stuff.
Oh, I was about to say, am I going to have my first casualty on a podcast? Because that would be terrible for you, but kind of good for me in a fucked up way.
I was taking a drink and I swallowed it wrong a little bit and choked and proved once again why I'm not fit to survive.
Yes. Drinking water is fairly difficult for you, Cam.
Yeah, it's literally like supposed to be the most simple of tasks, I feel like. We need it to survive, and I'm proving that I can't.
So. Yeah, I think it's the second most simplest. I think the simplest is breathing. But then again, people find a dumb way to screw that up.
That's very true too, man. It's very true. I do not forget how to breathe, luckily. So I'm 1 for 2, I guess.
You know what? 50%'s pretty good, yeah.
Yeah, man, that's a pretty good ratio. No, it's not. It's a bad ratio.
Well, then again, you need more air than you would water, I feel.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. You'll die from not breathing faster than you'll die from not drinking water.
Yeah, exactly. Like, if I threw you in, like, a river and you put your head underwater and you could drink all the water you want, but you have no air to breathe, you know, you're not going to last long.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I honestly think that has to be one of the worst ways to go.
Drowning?
Yeah.
Yeah, drowning would be pretty messed up. I think, honestly, I think being buried alive would be my worst way to die.
Yeah.
Like, out of the, you know, common ones, like being, like, burning alive, drowning, or being buried alive. Mm-hmm. I don't know if this is true, but I feel like I heard somewhere that, like, if you're being burned alive, you normally pass out from, like, lack of oxygen.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So, and I'm sure you'd honestly pass out, too, from the fucking pain.
Yeah.
Like, if you're fucking engulfed in flames, Jesus Christ. My shower water runs too hot, and I fucking cry about it. Yeah. Like, I couldn't imagine that shit. Fuck that.
And then you look at the Rage Against the Machine album for like 91, where the guy's basically in a yoga pose set on fire, and it's actually a true photo. Like, it actually did happen. Yeah.
Yeah, those dudes are fucking crazy. What is it, self-immolation or something?
Yeah, like he was protesting something. I don't remember the exact story or stuff like that. And he's like, all right, in protest of this, I'm going to set myself on fire. And he did, and he died. But you know, that I think that's the ultimate protest. I think that's something you would never see someone do for, like, Donald Trump or, you know, if Hillary Clinton got in. You know, no one will take it that extreme. Like, I think the worst that could happen is, or the worst that has happened, is they go and basically loot a whole bunch of stores. They break store windows, which I still don't understand why or how that's even effective. But anyways, I think that's, like, the worst thing. Like, no one would ever, like, self-inflict harm on themselves because of a president. Or especially this president.
Yeah. I went ahead and I looked up this guy. And I'll be honest, there's no way I'm going to be able to pronounce his name. So I apologize for that. Yeah. But it says that he was protesting the persecution of Buddhists by the South Vietnamese government. So that's some pretty heavy dedication to your religion.
It really is. But then again, was he... how am I going to word this correctly? Was he next? Like, was he going to be one of the ones that were going to be killed and basically said, you know what, I'm going to do it first? Like, for example, like, if, let's say, you know, a Jewish person back in World War II was protesting the Nazis in the concentration camps and ended up killing himself for the cause. Like, is that the same exact thing that's happening with this person, the Buddhist guy?
I'm looking through this guy's kind of, like, story. Uh-huh. I'm not really seeing a whole lot more than that. He was just, like, a normal monk.
Oh, okay.
Up until, like, that point. Like, it said he decided he wanted to be in isolation for several years, so he lived in isolation. No one knew where he was. And then he came back and he was back for a few years, and then he did the self-immolation. Shit. Yeah. That's freaking crazy.
I mean, what a way to go out.
Yeah, like, I mean, obviously that he's going to be famous forever, you know.
Yeah.
He's and it was for a great cause, you know. I've got a lot of respect for that.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Like, that's crazy. Like, I don't know. Tell you the truth, I don't know that I have that kind of dedication to a whole lot, you know.
Yeah, really. Well, let's
set myself on fire.
Yeah.
For that, holy cow.
Well, let's think about it. Is there anything in your life you would set yourself on fire for?
I would do it for my girlfriend and my friends, like uh-huh. my close friends. If I knew, like, they weren't going to be harmed if I did something like that.
Okay, so we're talking like a hostage situation type of deal. Okay.
Like, because, I mean, other than that, I can't think of a real reason that I would need to do that.
Yeah.
In anything other than, like, a hostage situation. But, I don't know, that's kind of it for me. Like, I don't have a whole lot of, like, my morals are kind of my own, like, I don't have a religion, or I don't kind of side with any specific political party. So to me, it's just like, yeah, whatever. Yeah, you say you're going to kill me if I don't say I'm a Republican. All right, fuck it. I'm a Republican. Like, I can tell you that all I want. That doesn't mean I actually feel that way about being a Republican. Like, just don't kill me. That's all I really care about.
Yeah, I think something like that happened, like going back to the Columbine shootings, or not really going to Columbine shootings. I think the two guys that were doing all the killing, I think, went up to random people and asked them if they were Catholic. If they said yes, they would shoot them. And then I think they got to some girl who was like basically was shaking. Obviously, you know, you have two machine guns pointed at you. It was obviously shaking, and I think they asked her if she was Catholic, and she was like, no, I'm not. And they shot her anyway, and they're like, yeah, you're a liar. I'm like, wow.
Oh my.
So it's a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like definitely in their case, they were crazy, man.
Yeah.
Like, you know, and they were crazy fucked up people, and there's crazy fucked up people everywhere. And they're all doing crazy fucked up things.
Yeah.
But I don't know, man. That shit always bums me out, you know? Obviously, you can't just ignore it, but it fucking sucks.
Yeah, I know.
But, like, people feel that strongly about anything that they want to literally murder somebody over it.
Yeah.
Like, that's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, like, how low do you have to get to be in that mindset of a killer? Be like, okay, I could solve all my problems if I take this gun and end all your lives. Like, how crazy does one have to get, or be, for that matter?
Dude, I literally want to turn myself into the police when I step on a dog's tail. Like, I cannot imagine wanting to inflict, like, murder on a human being. Like, I don't know, obviously that's hypocritical because I do hunt, but
yeah,
you know, whatever. I'm not perfect. Do as I say, not as I do, right?
Yeah. I think that's every smoker's PSA. I'm talking about cigarettes, not the other stuff, Cam.
Speaking of,
yeah, anyway, really.
yeah, no, but I don't know, man. I feel like I just kind of bounce all over the place.
Well, this is the perfect podcast for that. I mean,
yeah.
Wow, how do we even get to the subject?
Dude, I don't even know. I have got no idea where we started.
Oh my God.
We started 40 minutes ago.
I know.
And we have just nonstop just transitioned, like, with horrible segues, really, if you think about it. I've just been kind of saying whatever pops into my head.
Jesus. Wow. Like, I'm, like, literally trying to think of how we even got here. Like, I'm going to have to re-listen to this, and hopefully it goddamn saves, because if it doesn't, we're going to have a fucking problem. But
dude, I'll just load up another bowl, and we'll go for another podcast.
Hell yeah. Then we'll get into, like, something real deep, like the universe and how we're just a speck of sand.
Oh, man, don't even get me started, man. I've got a theory.
Okay. Yeah, I was about to say you better share it.
I got a Born of Osiris hat, and it's got like the Eye of Ra on it with the pyramid.
Uh-huh.
It's my little like Illuminati conspiracy hat now. Yeah. So I just put it on so I can say this theory. So I've got a theory that basically just kind of like how like and this is probably completely wrong, but it's okay.
We'll
Let me just have my thing.
Sure.
So I have a theory that that's fake news.
Fake news, wrong.
No, dude, I'm just giving out some alternative facts.
Yeah,
go for it. Basically, I came up with like an idea that like, what if like the universe, its life is cyclical. Like similar to like how like everything else or a lot of other things in the natural world operate on cycles. What if like similar to like, you know, how when stars are getting close to dying, they kind of like condense in on themselves and then explode outwards.
Yeah.
Like what if the universe does that? Like what if right now we're in the explosion process? That's why we're expanding outwards. But you know, we have the law of entropy. It says eventually, like, we'll run out of, you know, energy.
Mm-hmm.
What if when we start getting closer to that end of energy, we start condensing and we all get brought back together and then we fucking explode outwards and it starts all over again? And it's not like starts all over again in that, like, it starts all over and there's another Earth and there's another human race, but, like, literally just like a whole bunch of fucking rocks everywhere and stars and shit.
Hmm. Now
I'll tell you, I was kind of high when I came up with the idea. And I only talk about it when I'm high, so I don't even know if it sounds like a good idea to anyone sober. But, you know, that's my new religion. You can follow it. I'll make a Facebook page for it and everything.
There we go. And what are you going to call this said religion?
Oh, God. I have no idea. I didn't think of that.
All right, to be determined.
Yeah, it'll be like the religion of the experiment or something. We'll be like a band to start our own religion. Oh, my God.
Done.
Ghost does that.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, because Ghost, from what I understand, they actually file themselves like a religious visa when they travel in those places.
Wow, so that's genius.
Yeah, they don't have to tax most of the time.
Wow, that is really smart.
Yeah, but you'd have to probably go through several things to get to being able to do that, like legally. You know.
Yeah.
I would assume they would probably look into whether or not you're a real religion.
Yeah, I think they're just anti-Christ. I don't know how they're getting away with everything else, but.
Yeah. Who knows, man? It's a smart idea if it's true, though.
Yeah, it's brilliant. And the best part is, like, there's only one known member of Ghost, and he had to leave Ghost in order to expose his identity.
Did you know that Dave Grohl leaked that he was in Ghost once?
Yep, he played drums for him.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
Well, here, you want to hear something crazy and talk about conspiracies. Remember when Dave Grohl broke his leg?
Yeah.
Guess who the opening band was on that show?
Who?
It was Ghost.
Mother of God.
Exactly. So now you're talking about a former member of Ghost who's not a member anymore. And I'm not saying voodoo is real or fake, but you never know what Papa Emeritus is up to.
Oh my God. They're, like, doing some crazy cult shit and breaking people's legs and stuff. They're like, you leaked our secrets. Yeah. Snap. And you're like, wow, dude, that's a lot for being, like, a pop metal band.
Yeah. You sound like a satanic Duran Duran. That was the first thing that's the first thing I thought of when I listened to it. I was like, wow, this is really has an 80s vibe.
That's fantastic, dude.
Yeah.
I love that. Ghost is like a love hate for me. Like I'll listen to him and I'll be like, I don't know why I'm still listening to this, but I am. I don't know. That's just my personal taste.
Have you ever seen them live?
I've not. I've wanted to because it looks really fucking cool.
It is incredible.
Hell yeah, dude. I need to check it out.
Yeah, and I'm still holding out for like probably the most, I guess, sought after anti-Christ tour with them and King Diamond on one bill.
That would be super sick, dude. I think it would be super cool if they got, like, Behemoth on there, too.
Yeah, or throw in, like, Slayer or something like that.
Dude, fucking Behemoth is sick. I love shit like that. I love culty music. It's just so, like, it's so intense to me, you know?
Yeah.
I like, intense stuff. I've been kind of, in my free time, writing some, like, really dark, like, classical music. Like writing like scores and stuff, and it's just been a whole lot of fun because I love like just like listening to a lot of just very like calm but kind of spooky sounding classical music.
I hear you there. Now, if you're looking for a good like soundtrack to listen to with what you just described, listen to the Social Network soundtrack. It's done by Atticus Rose and Trent Reznor, and the entire thing is like a huge trip, and I don't think there's even one vocal or like one spoken word on the entire thing. The entire thing's instrumental and it's just very moody, and it's incredible, dude.
I'm gonna pull it up and favorite it right now.
Hell yeah, man. From the first track, you'll be in because it's just, I think, like six notes on a piano. It just goes dun, 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 dun. And you'll Hell listen yeah. to it. You're like, okay, this is odd. And then it just builds up, builds up, builds up. And you're like, oh my God, this is more than just six notes.
Boom. I just added it to my favorites. I'm going to check that shit out tonight on my drive to band practice.
You got band practice tonight?
Yes, I do.
Holy crap.
Yeah, man, but here it's 7:30 right now for me. So, yeah. You know, we normally practice late at night, too, because we all have daytime jobs.
Mm-hmm.
So normally none of us can even meet up until close to 11 o'clock.
Oh, wow.
But we have our own little practice space. It's actually in the ghetto. But,
in the ghetto.
Yeah. It's pretty fun out there. Like, I don't know. Like, it's literally one of those places that we'll be walking down the street and people, like, they'll see a group of white kids walking down the street there. And, like, white people will pull over and be like, are you guys lost? Like, that's how, like,
no, dear,
fucking funny it is.
No, dear, it's I so think they're just scoring funny. Drugs. Don't even say anything. Let's just keep going.
And we're like, no, we stay out here. But, we have practice tonight. We're going to be working on our set for a shameless plug. So What Music Festival.
Oh, yeah, March that's right.
25th.
Day two, right?
Yep, day two with We the Kings, Puya,
yep.
Attila,
Mayday Parade, After the Burial.
Dude, Amir's new album. Have you listened to it yet?
I saw the music video for, was it Smokeless? Smoke something.
Smokey,
there we go.
Yeah.
And I heard what they did there. I was like, the beginning of the song, I was like, okay, this is generic shit. Until the end of it, where it was just like the guitar doing those different like tones. I was like, oh my God, this is pretty cool.
Yeah, it was, well, what I kind of love about Amir is that like, while technically, yeah, you could label them as generic, I don't consider them generic because I feel like they invented generic. You know, like they were one of the earlier bands to kind of pioneer breakdowns only for an entire song, in the way that they do it, especially. So I don't know. I kind of enjoy when bands, like when there's a few bands that maintain the same sound over the years, because it means I always have something to listen to from them. But I also enjoy when bands grow and change sounds completely, you know? Yeah. So I guess mine is super dependent on the band.
Yeah.
You know?
It's crazy. I used to be so big into Amir, like Goodbye to the Gallows Days. Like, you know, just the first track on there, I think it was a Ticket to the Paralyzer off the top of my head. It's literally just the breakdown. Like, he just says, like, dun, 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 dun. And it's just one word that Frankie says. It just goes, go. And I'm like, oh, okay. Like, you really just want to just start moshing wherever the hell you are.
Yeah, dude. I miss, like, music like that. I feel like there's, like, not a ton of bands that make me feel that way, like, immediately. Like, there's a lot of bands that are composing, like, wonderful music, like, don't get me wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'm meaning, like, the way, like, Amir just, like, that early shit, or, like, even early Acacia Strain, like, for whatever reason, maybe it was just my personality back then. Mm-hmm. Like, that's probably it, to be honest with you. But back then, it used to be like when that breakdown slapped, I would be like, fuck yes. And I just started like headbanging wherever I was, you know. I mean, I still do that, actually. I do that in the car a lot. I actually, last week, my girlfriend and I were on the porch. My girlfriend was smoking a cigarette, and I was showing her some song from a band that I'm sure she doesn't even like. And I was, like, playing air guitar to it, and I was, like, headbanging and, like, jumping up and down and stuff. And just the neighbors walked by and embarrassed my girlfriend and stuff, so.
As they should.
Yeah, yeah, because I'm an embarrassing human being. I mean, I should stop doing things like that, but I probably won't.
Eh, who cares?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, who cares? They're gonna walk away. Like I said earlier, they're gonna forget about me in the next hour anyway.
And the funny part is, like, think about it. See, that is, like, I quote unquote embarrassing what you did, like playing air guitar and banging your head. But if you're on stage in front of 500 people and you do that, it's the coolest thing in the world.
Exactly. That's actually that's actually what I said to her. I was like, it's so funny that it's like that's what my guitarists do when they're on stage. Well, exactly what I was doing, because I wasn't doing anything like goofy. I was literally just like pretending to play guitar and like banging my head with it or something. And so I was like, that's so funny that to anybody else they're like nerd. Oh my god. Who knows, man? I feel like I'm embarrassing a whole lot. I had somebody today right before I got on this podcast. We were talking, and in the middle of us talking, they were like, Cam, you know something? You're a really weird guy to talk to sometimes.
Oh, Jesus.
And he was like, look, it's not like a bad thing, but like sometimes I'm just like, what the fuck are you talking about? Oh, man. And it's true. But I don't care.
Yeah.
Because I'm just literally saying whatever pops on my brain, my noggin.
Exactly. And this is, I think, the worst format to, like, bring all that out.
Yeah, who knows, man? Jeez. Who knows? I feel like, honestly, I hope that everybody that listens to this particular episode, I hope they're all smoking. because it'll make it a lot easier to follow along, because your brain will be more ready to just transition as fast as we are. You'll be a lot more prepared for that, because if you're sober, you're going to probably be annoyed with me.
Well, but I'm completely sober right now, and I'm enjoying the hell out of this. But then again, I'm the type of person that I like these conversations that if I hear on different podcasts I listen to – Like I'm sick and tired of the same, you know. All right, yeah, let's talk about the music. And you know, you could tell the bands and the artists are on there like saying the same exact robotic answers. Yeah, the new album's great, you know. We worked with with this producer and we have 12 tracks coming up and it's great, you know. I talked about dogs and kittens and then slaying them with a sword because we're in a metal band, rawr. And it's like the same, like it's all rehearsed. While this is basically like, okay, so what the hell you want to talk about? Hey, let's talk about this, and then we basically transitioned to some really dark shit, and then we went to some really weird shit. But that's,
Yeah, dude.
yeah.
Who, but I mean, hopefully people enjoy it. I hope. I hope.
Yeah, it's kind of hard not to enjoy that. I mean, I understand like if
It's
you're like a really big fan of what you do and you're like, "Oh my God, I really hope they go in, they talk about this one album that they did and this one song that was like really great in this one part." It's like, yeah, I mean, I can do that, but I'm pretty sure you've said your piece on it, whether online or, you know, in another interview. I'm not too sure. So, you never know.
Yeah, usually I try to just, not really talk about the music, let the music talk for itself. Like I'll mention real quick that we do have a new song coming out. It's probably coming out next week. I don't have an official date because we've got to see about we're getting a video back for it. And basically, it's going to be a surprise drop. Like we're going to get it back and drop the video the same day we get it back.
Not anymore, it's not.
So
Yeah,
yeah, well, it still will be because it'll be at some point
that's true.
in the next week because I don't even know, so I couldn't even tell you.
And due to our scheduling, I think this episode's coming out on Wednesday, so it couldn't possibly out be out by then. You never know.
Yeah, you never know. I would doubt it. I probably wouldn't believe it for a moment, but maybe. Who knows, dude?
Hey.
Who freaking knows? Because this process has gone a lot faster than I even expected, honestly, on this song. Like the dude fucking he put so much like time for like 5 days straight into just mixing this song and got it back to us and it sounds incredible. Dude, his name's Ludwig and he lives in Sweden.
But
And
of course.
yeah, right.
It's like a Hans. It's like, yeah, we know a Hans and he's from, let me guess, Sweden.
Yeah, right. But he's the one mixing it, and he's awesome, dude. Like we've been really impressed and really, really satisfied with the product we got back, which, if I'm not mistaken, we'll play a little clip of at the end for anyone that wants to stick around and check it out.
Well, if they lasted this long, I'm pretty sure they're going to last until the end.
Yeah, I would be really shocked if someone got to like minute like 55 and was like, nah.
I'm out.
Like this is dumb. Like
Oh, they could talk about setting yourself on fire and serial killers, but music, no.
yeah, right? Jesus Christ. Dude, have you ever thought about like statistically, someone probably died where you are right now.
Define where I am. Like,
What,
meaning, like, what are
like
you saying?
in your room, like, or like in even in your apartment, you could even say in your if you have an apartment or a house, but like not in your literal apartment, but like at some point on the ground that was once there before the building, I'm sure. Like especially you, like up in you're in New Jersey, right?
That is correct.
So I mean that's some pretty densely populated stuff up there compared to what I'm used to, at least. Here I can drive 2 hours and I can be in the middle of nowhere
Yeah.
and it's awesome. I
Unless your
love
car
that
burns
shit,
down.
dude. Yeah, man, but then, we live in Texas, man, so we're all mechanics, I guess.
Yeah, that's true, yeah.
No, actually, you'd be surprised, man. There's a lot of there like that Southern hospitality stuff, like you wouldn't believe it, but like that's helped us out in a lot of tough times. I've been surprised, like I don't know, like we've had our van breakdown before, and we've had like random people out of nowhere like stop and like they attached our trailer to their truck and then drove us all to a motel while we got our van towed. And like it was just some random like couple that was just on like a road trip, like they were in their 50s, and they were just like, yeah, we saw you were broken down, we'll just, you know, figured we'd stop, help out. Jesus. I was like, what the fuck, dude? Like, that's so sick. Like, they literally just, they said they drove by and saw us and turned around and came back to help. And I was like, man, like, that's really going out of your way. Like, that's really cool.
God damn. Something like that ever happened in New Jersey, you're going to get something thrown at you, and then the driver's like filming it.
You're like waiting for the tow truck to show up to tow your van, and then someone just steals your van instead.
Yeah. It's like, okay, there's like four flat tires. Good luck stealing it.
They just steal the rims.
Yeah.
I don't even – do people still do that? Do people still steal rims?
I don't know. I remember like rims being a big thing like 10 years ago, like with the whole like Pimp My Ride thing. When that came out, everyone loved the tricked out rims, and obviously everyone got theirs stolen. But I don't think anyone's really going with the tricked out rims anymore. And in that case, you know, who the hell wants to steal like a regular Nissan Sentra's rims? You know, it's like, okay.
Dude, in that case, I'm going to put some super fucking sick rims on my 99 Corolla.
Yes.
Like, that has, like, a bunch of dents in it from where it's been hit. Like, just the whole car itself looks like shit, but have really, really nice rims on it.
Oh, God.
People would be like, what the fuck are your priorities, dude?
Well, it's like getting those, like, getting those beat-up cars and then putting, like, the loud-ass exhaust on them.
Oh, dude, there's so many people like that around here.
I know. Oh, my God.
Like, Texas, dude, everybody has a loud exhaust. Like, I feel like it's the point, like, in my complex where almost every truck in this complex is so loud that it sounds like the garbage truck is driving in every single time. Like, it's ridiculous. And they all have those ridiculous fucking, I forget what kind of lights they're called, but they're the headlights that are really fucking bright.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, dude. They all have those.
They're like floodlights almost.
Yeah, dude, and it freaks me out too, because, I mean, obviously, I'm stoned, I'm paranoid, and they're like so bright that I'm like, dude, it's a cop.
I know it, I know it, I know it!
He knows I'm high.
It'd be like that scene in Super Troopers in the beginning scene where they're like, you gotta eat the drugs. What?
You gotta eat them.
Dude, the schnozberries taste like schnozberries.
That's so fucking great, dude.
Oh, God almighty.
Dude, have you checked out the re-release of Born of Osiris?
I haven't yet, no.
Dude, listen to it. It's so sick. They, like, reworked a lot of the guitar parts and redid the vocals and stuff. It sounds really, really good.
Oh, sweet.
The synth player, I think his name is Joe or Joel or something.
Mm-hmm.
He jumped in to, they played Gas Monkey Bar and Grill last night, and there's like a kind of a pond behind the stage. The stage is outside and it's on like a dock almost. And he, at the end of their song, like ran and like jumped into it. And I mean, it was, you know, obviously you were saying earlier that it's like 20 something degrees up there.
Yeah.
And so obviously me saying it was cold and it was 60 degrees, it's not that cold, but it was 60 degrees out. So it wasn't like necessarily whether you want to be jumping into water.
Yeah.
You know, so, but he came out and security tried to tell him he had to leave. And he just laughed at him and walked on stage and did one more encore song, and then they left. But that was sick, dude. And Volumes played a brand new song, like one they haven't released yet.
Oh, shit.
Because the latest release, have you listened to that?
What was their latest release?
The one On Your Mind, On Her Mind with Puya.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I wasn't a big fan of that one personally.
Yeah, it was okay.
I liked Feels Good, so I was like, you know, still keeping, you know, hope, because, you know, 50-50.
Yeah.
But they played a new one last night that, like, completely sold me. Like, I feel like if they were willing to write something like they did last night, like, and perform it, then they're probably, this new album's probably going to be pretty freaking good.
Yeah, I don't think they put out a bad album yet.
I don't either, dude. Like, I really don't. That's why I just, you know, I've been remaining pretty optimistic.
Yeah.
But tonight there's a fucking show going on that's sold out. Fucking Silent Planet, dude.
Yeah, that band's getting huge.
I can't believe that, man. That's awesome.
Yeah, I think
seems
they were
like they kind of came out of nowhere.
Yeah, and I think last year they were on like a small ass stage at Warped Tour, and they only played for like 10 dates or something like that. Kevin loved them so much, I think they got bumped up to a bigger stage and played the entire tour.
That's so sick.
Yeah, but good for them, man. Holy shit.
Hell yeah. Do you guys have any do you have any locals up there that I should check out? That everyone should check out? That you endorse, or do you hate everybody?
Oh yeah, fuck them. If they say no to my show, fuck them.
That's what I'm saying, dude. That's what I've been saying for years, dude. If you don't agree to 50 pre-sales at $30 a piece for a show on a Thursday night, then you are not cool in my book.
Oh, God, dude.
Take down notes, all right?
Dude, I have such a funny-ass story for that. I was in a band with Dan, who's my co-host, who's somewhere. I don't even know where the hell Dan is right now. But, you know, we were both in a band together, and the opportunity came up where we could have opened for Adelita's Way. I was like, oh, that's pretty fucking cool. And the promoter's like, oh yeah, I've never actually heard of them. I was like, oh, they're great. They had they have a couple of good albums. I think one song was like really popular on mainstream rock. You know, they're okay. And the guy's like, oh, okay, cool. Do you want to open? I was like, okay, what are the details? He's like, it's a Tuesday night in January, and I think we could go with 20 pre-sales. I'm like, all right, you know what? 20's not that bad. So I was like, all right, let me talk with the rest of the band. I'll get back to you. He's like, okay. Talk with the rest of the band. And the rest of the band's like, oh, okay. So that's only 5 tickets we have to sell each at like, you know, $15. It's like, yeah. They're like, all right, fuck it. We're in. It's like, cool. We're going to open up for Adelaide's Way. Message him back. He goes, 20. Oh, I didn't mean 20. I meant 40. I was like, whoa, why'd you double the number? He goes, yeah, they have like 567,000 fans on Facebook. I think they're going to really pack the house, and you should have no problem selling 40. I was like, motherfucker, like an hour ago, you had no idea who the hell these guys were. And now you decide to do some research, and now you're jacking it up? Screw that. Fuck we're that. Done. Yeah.
Fuck that. I always say agree to the lowest number you can and sell way more than that.
Yeah.
That's always been my policy. That's the smart way to do it, man. Like, keep the risk low, reward high, man. What is that fucking Jesus Christ, Wolf on Wall Street?
Yeah.
That, God damn it, I shouldn't even be quoting that. That's a bad movie to quote.
Why? It's an amazing movie to quote.
Oh, it's an amazing movie, but man, those are some crazy dudes.
And it was
way crazier
real.
Than I could be, man. Yeah, way crazier than I could ever be.
Yeah, but then again, if you give coke addicts in the 80s unlimited money and the chance to make even more money and be like, well, here's unlimited money, do the craziest thing you think of. Like, okay, why don't we just have midgets and we're going to throw them up on a dartboard. Done.
Oh, my God. I would do it, dude. I'd throw midgets at a dartboard, like, as long as the midgets consented, you know?
Yeah.
As long as they were like, yeah, dude, you can throw me.
It's not like they went down to, like, a couple blocks like, away stole. And grabbed one. Be like, I got one.
They just fucking kidnapped a bunch of midgets.
Oh, God.
That would be so fucked up, dude.
That'd be an interesting movie, though.
I also don't know that that's even the politically correct term, but I don't
I think it's
shit.
Little person. I don't know.
I don't know. I'm sorry if I've been insensitive to anybody listening, but at the same time, don't blame me for being ignorant. Just tell me the right way to say it. I promise I'll do it in the future.
Yeah,
that's how I live. Like, I'm sorry if I hurt your feelings, like, by calling you something you didn't like. Just correct me. Like, you don't be an asshole.
Yeah.
Like, the people that get, like, really, really, really mad about, like, misgendering and stuff. Well, it's like, dude, sometimes you don't know. Like, let's be, like, fucking fair.
Exactly, yeah.
Like, so, like, just be nice about it. Like, honestly, I feel like 9 times out of 10, if you're nice about it to them, they'll be nice back.
Yeah.
Like, if you're just like, hey, I prefer this. I know it's a lot easier said than done.
Of course.
Because I obviously understand that kind of shit's awkward when it's, like, real. Because, I mean, I get misgendered. I get called ma'am a whole lot.
Do you really?
Yeah, just from behind. I mean.
Okay, all right.
Because I've got pretty long hair, and it's in, like, I've got 3 braids, and they're pink, and, like, I wear girls' jeans. I mean, it's, you know, it's fair from behind to say ma'am, but, you know, I always just laugh it off, you know, turn around, laugh it off. Normally they laugh it off, move on, you know, like it doesn't have to be that serious.
Yeah. You don't have to start like filming with your cell phone and be like, this bastard misgendered me. Fuck you, you cisgender scum.
Yeah. I literally feel like when people do stuff like that, it just creates more of a divide between the people. So then those conversations that people feel like we shouldn't be having still are still being had. Like, the bathroom situation. Who fucking cares,
Yeah,
dude?
That's a weird one, yeah.
It wasn't a fucking problem before. Like, the only reason it's a problem is because a lot of people are trying to make it a problem on both sides.
Yeah.
Like, including the people themselves that are saying they're getting persecuted. Like, sometimes you, like... Okay, I'm trying to think of how to say this the nicest way possible, but, like, also it's kind of, like, shitty.
Yeah, just let it
out. The world sucks. Like, that's just it. Like, they're going to be – the people are going to be fucking mean to you all the time. Like, that's just going to happen. All you can do is figure out how you're going to take that information in and deal with it. If you're going to run around and you're going to cry and film everyone and fucking scream at them, you're going to live a fucking miserable life.
Mm-hmm.
Like – spend your time like being happy about you know what yourself and the way you are and spread that kind of positivity around. I bet you'll get a lot more people on your side.
Absolutely.
You know? You'll get a lot more people willing to listen to you. You know, obviously there are certain things where you do have to kind of stand up and fight for what's right, but I think things like misgendering, that's just, you know, pick your battle.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? I just feel like there's a lot worse things we need to figure out, even within that. Like, let's, like, make sure we've secured just equal rights for marriage first. Because, like, we've already got, you know, the Trump administration trying to repeal stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Or at least talking about it.
Yeah, I think Trump is the one that's cool about gay marriage, but you have the vice president who's going at, you know, who's basically one of those Bible bumpers where everything is, you know, it's the spoken word of God from something that was supposedly written, you know, 2,000 years ago when the earth was created. But, you know, that's what they think of. But, you know, I think that's the problem with that is if there was an updated Bible by this pope, and he was able to update things. Like, you know, this pope supposedly is cool. Like, he's cool with, like, the gays and stuff like that. And, you know, I don't think he'd be down to marrying them just because he's in the power position that he's in. But if he was able to recreate the Bible and say that homosexuality is not a sin, how many people would actually read that Bible and just go, oh, okay, God said it's not a sin. Okay, that's cool. We're cool now.
What would be super funny to me is that none of them would believe it. They would, like, all these Christians, they would find out that this new pope changed things, and they'd say, well, what gives you the right to do it? And they would all question him, even though that's the exact way it was written before.
Yeah.
Like, what gives them the authority to say that the Pope doesn't have direct communication with God? You know, obviously, like I said before, I don't believe in God at all, but I like playing the devil's advocate, you know? I like saying, you know, challenging their own logic, you know, like that, I don't know. I think this new Pope is really cool. I actually, as funny as it is, I have a picture of him that one of my Catholic friends gave to me, and I keep it in my car. He gave it to me because his mom asked that I had it because she felt like there needed to be someone protecting me. So I took that as a kind gesture, and I put it in my car.
Yeah.
So I've got a picture of the Pope in my car. That's a fun fact that I'm sure not a whole lot of people would believe. But
and I'd say about 90% of hardcore Catholics don't have a picture of the Pope in their car. So you just wound up like 90% of a religion, and you don't even believe in it, so to speak.
That's so funny, dude. Yeah. I've never thought about it that way. I am, dude. I'm schooling them right now.
Yeah.
Up and down the street, man. I'm being a better Christian than most of them, to be honest with you.
There you go. I'd be like, hey, do you have Pope Francis in your car? What, is his name Francis? I don't know what the hell his name is.
Dude, I think it is.
Oh.
I'm going to look it up, though, because I don't want to be wrong on that. That exactly. would be embarrassing.
It'd be like, well, you call yourself a Catholic? Oh, what, you go to church every Sunday? I take it one step further. I have Pope Francis looking at me and everything I do in my vehicle.
Okay, so, his name's Pope Francis.
Yes! There we go.
I have to tell you a funny story about when they were picking this new Pope. I was with the same family that gave me the picture of this Pope, which I guess, you know, kind of thinking about it now is kind of funny. But they're super Catholic, and I was over at their house while, like, all that was going on, while they were trying to decide who the new Pope would be. And his mom was going on this whole rant about how, like, there's a prophecy that says that whenever the leader of the world is a black man, that we're going to get a black pope, and that's going to be the last pope that there ever is. And, like, was telling me this whole long fucking conspiracy, or, like, not even conspiracy, like, it was a real prophecy that she, like, said was, like, a real thing that, like, she believed. And I can't forget how funny it was when, like, they announced the new Pope and it was a white dude. It was just so funny to me. I was like, man, that's just wrong. You're just wrong. Like, she was like,
where do you come up with that shit from?
Yeah, and it was funny because it was so specific. Like, like she said that it said that the 50th. I forget what it was. It was, she like even had numbers like that she was like referencing this whole time. I mean, obviously like 99% of these people with fucking their end of the world theories, they bring numbers out of their ass because people will believe it because it's a number.
Yeah.
You know, people are like, numbers, they're facts. Like,
2012 was a big thing for like a day, and they're like, okay, cool.
They even made a fucking successful movie out of that shit.
That they did.
Like, I remember, you know, what's funny is actually I didn't go to see that movie. I still haven't seen that movie because end of the world shit fucks me up. Like, I'm not trying to fucking think about that shit, man. I'm trying to watch, like, Lord of the Rings. Dude, I'm trying to see some hobbits, man. Some fucking orcs get cut off. I'm not trying to see fucking New York City like be swallowed by a tsunami from some crazy meteor. It's not worth my time.
Jeez.
I'm fucking picky on my movies, man.
As you should be. As everyone is. No one sees every movie.
It's true. Have you seen the new Logan yet?
I have not, but I hear rave reviews.
Yeah, I haven't seen it either. But I was going to go see it today, and then lying in bed, and I was thinking to myself, it's literally the first weekend it's out. Fuck that.
Yeah. Especially being a superhero movie too, yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be so busy on a Saturday night.
Yeah.
And what sucks even more is, you know good and well, no matter how people beg and plead parents not to take their kids to see that fucking movie, parents are going to take their kids, and it'll be on a Saturday that they would do that shit. So I'm not trying to fucking go on a Saturday when kids are being rushed out of the theater because mommy doesn't want little Johnny to hear fuck.
Yeah.
Like, because she doesn't want him to know real fucking life.
Yeah, which is weird because, you know, I was thinking of something like that before. Like, you know, everyone who says that, like the proper, I guess, literary people, like the scholars, as people would call them, you know, look down at cursing as being uneducated. So, like, if, you know, I walk down the street and I stub, or like I fell and just went, ah, fuck, and be like, oh, oh yeah, and you'll that person will think poorly of me because of the words that I utter out of my mouth. But then again, if something went wrong with them, you know, they'll say something as stupid as, like, fiddlesticks. Like, what sounds worse, saying fuck or fiddlesticks?
My argument has always been that the intent is exactly the same.
Yeah.
That is, like, ever since I was a kid, because I used to get in trouble a lot for language.
Yeah.
Because I like, from a young age, that was something that I felt strongly about, was like, but why does it matter? Like, what's the difference between saying dang and damn? Like, I'm thinking damn when I say dang anyway.
Yeah.
Like, and my family was super religious. And by their logic, you know, they said even thinking of things like that was a sin. So, I mean, the way I saw it was like, fuck, dude, if I'm already sinning, like, might as well say it out loud, you know?
Might as well, yeah.
I'm already fucked, like.
Actually, you're more honest with God, though.
Yeah, dude, yeah. And I feel like he respects that, you know? Shout out.
shout out to Jay Christ, what up?
Yeah, shout out, dude. Hit me up.
or you know what? Don't hit me up for a while. I don't want to die.
Yeah, dude, no. Yeah, don't hit me up. Stay up there.
Yeah, just watch over me. We cool. I got Francis in my car. We chilling.
Yeah, right. It's super, but like, to all my friends, like the Pope Francis in my car is so ironic because, like, I'm sitting over here, like, my right arm is like a majority, like, things that religious people wouldn't like. Like, I have Lucifer's sigil on my, like, wrist, like on my forearm. And then I have, like, a hexagram. I have the Satanic cross, like the Levan cross. I have fucking a pentacle, got Baphomet, and then on my wrist, like right above my hand, I have the new Jesus.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's super funny for me to be cruising around in my little car and have fucking Pope Francis hanging out with me on my dashboard. It makes me feel a little more comfortable. It makes me feel like if a cop pulls me over, they're going to see the Pope Francis and be like, what a good guy.
Carry on, sir.
Yeah, right? Like, I could look at him and be like, my eyes are super red, and I'm like, sorry, I was just crying on my way home from church. And he'd be like, I understand. And I'd get away with it, man.
Oh, God. I'm sure someone had to have pulled that off before.
Dude, I'm literally going to try now. I think I'm going to go buy, like, a rosary and stuff. And, yeah, like, hang it from – I'm sorry if this is offending Catholic people, but I don't care, man. I'm trying to get out of getting in trouble. I'm going to hang a rosary and, like, put my Pope Francis up, and then I'll just pretend to be super religious every time I get pulled over.
Jeez.
Dude, I bet – dude, it's, like – it probably won't – it probably wouldn't mean a whole lot, like, up north, I feel like. But, like, in the south, like, if you had that shit popping, you would be good, man.
Especially a person your age.
Yeah, like, if I was driving around with that rosary hanging around, like, they would let me go so fast. Like, Texas cares way too much about, like, Christian religions.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Okay. Do you remember – this will be a fun story. Do you remember when those people that worked for that fucking newspaper in France.
Yeah.
Were attacked for their drawings of Muhammad.
Yeah, of course.
Did you hear about the thing in Texas with that?
Oh, where they did a draw Muhammad competition?
Yeah, and then when people showed up, like, to, like, attack him, they shot him.
Yeah.
I was like, dude, that's fucking Texas in a nutshell, dude. Like, that's literally, that's how it is here. Like, it's fucking crazy, man. I don't even know. Like, here, actually, in a couple other states, I know, like, Arkansas, too, if you're an atheist, you can't hold public office. So,
but how would you know that?
I've looked into it.
No. I mean, not the information. How would people know that they're an atheist unless they flat out said it?
Yeah, I mean, they'd have to say it. You'd have to like look into their background or something. The way I saw it is like, I always just was like, I'll just lie.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, to tell you the truth, I would assume a lot of presidents just lie anyway about that shit. Yeah. Like, I have a strong feeling that Obama wasn't actually a Christian. Not that I care, but I feel like he played the role. Like,
yeah,
I feel like if anything, he'd fall more like, he strikes me as like an agnostic kind of guy. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, I feel like Obama's just the kind of like, I'm not really sure. We don't have all the information. And I'm just like, all right, man, cool, sweet.
Yeah,
I can get down.
Yeah, he just basically throws the lawyer angle at you. Be like, well, I don't have enough evidence on this, and this is I'm not going to say anything about it, and that's what I'm going to say.
I remember the first time I saw Donald Trump try to use that logic. He was talking about fucking David Duke and the KKK.
I know, like, nothing about him.
You saw that? You endorse him? And he was like, I don't know anything about the white supremacists, I don't know anything about their movement. I'm like, how do you not know? Like, where have you been fucking living? You know, you're probably fucking part of it. Oh, someone's going to be knocking on my door now. Like, you can't say that about Donald Trump.
Like, oh, wow, people are listening to this podcast. That's great.
Yeah, right? I'd be stoked. I'd, like, shoot you a text. I'd be like, dude, monetize this shit. We're about to get so many fucking plays, dude. I'm getting arrested. Dude, I wouldn't blame you, man. You know what? If that anything like that ever happens, then I give you full permission to, like, go the whole nine yards with it. I want T-shirts. I want hats. all because of this particular podcast that got me arrested. All right?
Done. We'll do like a little free cam merch line type of deal.
Oh my god, that'd be so funny. And then just like in quotes, like on the back, put exactly what I said about Donald Trump.
He knew about the KKK.
Because he was part of it.
Yeah. Oh my god.
Dude, who knows, man? I mean, we're really, like, realistically, we're only a couple steps away from stuff like that. Like, I know, like, that sounds extreme, but when people start talking about things like, we're only going to allow specific media sources in that I myself approve of, that's when you start dealing with, you know, okay, we're going to be getting a lot of misinformation now, because it's all going to be fucking biased.
Yeah.
And that kind of shit scares me.
Yeah, I do see somewhat both sides of this, but obviously he's taking it to another extreme. If he would have said, look, I'm not bringing in BuzzFeed because they came out with the story about the Russian prostitutes pissing on me, and obviously that's not true, you know, whether you believe it or not. He'd be like, look, they lied about me, they tried to slander me, why would I allow them in on this when they could just turn the facts and, you know, try to screw me again. I know their agenda is extremely biased towards the left. You know what? I don't want that. I'm going to stick with the Washington Post. Yes, it is, you know, a Republican-based magazine, or I don't even know if it is. But, you know, then he also – then he goes with, like, Breitbart. I'm like, oh, no. So, like, he starts off well, and then he takes things to, like, the utmost extreme. And I think the same could be said about Milo. You know, with his whole thing, you know, obviously, I think it might have gotten taken a little out of context about the whole pedophilia thing. I honestly think, and this is just my beliefs and reading of what I found, I think he was abused as a child, and the way he's always been covering it up was by saying that he was the dominant one, because that's his character, or that's basically the person he is. He wants to be the dominant voice. He wants to go and outrage people. But in that specific moment, he was the victim. And I think that's what screwed everything up in his life, in his psychiatric, that's fucking things up. I think that's the main source of everything. But
yeah, I don't know. I think I honestly, I never checked out the video of Milo, whatever he was talking about the other day that got him in trouble, with everyone calling him a pedophile,
yeah,
or at least a pedophile sympathizer or whatever. I've watched his videos in the past. He's a lot like Trump in my eyes, where he can make some valid points, but because of the rest of him as a human being the way it is, I don't like him.
Yeah.
Like, kind of like his whole attitude on everything, it's just real shitty to me. And I think, like, once again, like, to me, he's just as bad as the kids on the left that, you know, I was talking about crying and
yeah,
fucking filming all the time. Like, you're not any better than them, like, no, by fucking getting on all these videos on YouTube and just basically insulting people's intelligence all day. Like, have some fucking reasonable discussion. Obviously, there's a lot of videos I've watched too, though, that the people approaching him didn't approach him for a reasonable discussion.
So can you
really blame him for being hostile right back? You know, like,
yeah, he's always in defense mode.
Yeah, people kind of, I feel like people forget a lot of times that these guys that, like, we all hate, it's almost like a fucking self-destructive cycle for them, because we all hate them, so we express that we hate them, and they get defensive, which makes us hate them more, and then it just gets worse and worse, and so we just can't stand the people, and we find something about them that we're like, yeah, fuck that person completely.
Exactly, yeah.
Like, Milo. Like, it was only a matter of time before, because that, wasn't that video, from what I understand, wasn't that an old video?
Yeah, it was like a year or two ago, where he basically just said that, like, gay teens or, yeah, I think it was just gay teens, and forgive me if I fuck this up, but the point of it was saying, like, gay teens need an older role model to basically show them the ropes type of deal. So he said that there was nothing wrong with, like, a 13 or 14-year-old guy, you know, having an adult friend, I don't want to say, like, fuck him, or basically, like, be a protector type of deal. I think that's where he went with everything. And then he went into the story about, you know, what happened with him, and I think it was a priest. And he cracked the joke saying, yeah, if it wasn't for Father Dave, or whatever the hell guy's name is, if it wasn't for Father Dave, I wouldn't be able to give such good head. You know, something like that, which was kind of funny. It's like, okay, you know, if it was a stand-up comedian on stage saying that, you know, I'd probably get a couple of chuckles. But just for him being the person that he is, I think everyone took that to the utmost extreme and said that he endorses, you know, pedophilia and endorses, like organizations like NAMBLA. And I don't think he does. I think, like I said before, he's a victim of this, and he just doesn't want to be the victim anymore. He wants to be the powerful person in anything and everything that he does. Doesn't make what he said right or wrong, but I think there is an ulterior motive that, you know, it's weird. Like, I don't know what's a person, what's the character. Like, looking at someone like Kanye West, I don't know what, if he's an asshole in real life. But, you know, I don't know. People can't separate both the character and the real-life person, and I think that's what Milo's downfall was.
I think, once again, I haven't done a whole lot of research onto this, but based off what you're saying, I think it's a case, I don't know, like you said, you don't watch YouTube. But I don't know if you've heard the stuff going on about PewDiePie.
Yeah, that was odd from what I've been hearing. I didn't see anything, but from what I'm hearing,
Basically, he was labeled an anti-Semite because he said, because he went on that website, Fiverr, where you can pay $5 to people to do basically whatever you ask them to. Like, and he paid these two guys that didn't speak any English, or at least so they claim, to write a write on a sign, "Death to all Jews," and then dance with it. And but this was one among, like, literally hundreds of things that he sent out. Like, and all of them being, like, offensive or just real, like, ridiculous, because it's like, really, who's going to do that for $5? And so I, to some degree, I understood what he was fucking doing. But it was like, at the end of the day, what I think it comes down to is it's a bad joke. Like, it doesn't make him... like, he doesn't hate Jews. It was just a bad fucking joke, was all it was. Like, it was like, because it wasn't, you know, necessarily hilarious, you know, like watching that video, I wasn't really like, oh, ha ha ha, like, I wasn't dying. I was like, oh, he actually got them to do that. Okay. Like, but also when I watched it, I never once in my mind thought, this guy hates Jews. Like, I think there's just a real problem with the media, like, finding something and they hype it to a point where the real information can't even be seen anymore. And then you've just got people sharing things all over the internet for nothing more than what the title of the article reads. And going off the title as, like, fact. Like, they won't even read what it says. In the article. So, I mean, that kind of stuff, like, pisses me off.
Yeah, funny you should bring that up. Like, there's, I remember a story about, this happened, I want to say, last summer or last fall, where that one YouTuber did a quick live Facebook video where he was getting kicked off a plane for just speaking to his mother in Arabic, but he's a well-known, like, prankster type of deal. You remember that guy?
Oh yeah.
And the funniest part was, like, it came out, like, there was, like, testimonies from other passengers saying, okay, he was doing something similar, he was trying to start a riot or something like that, and then he went on Facebook video and tried to play the victim. And once that came out, the media, like, went from, you know, oh, this person has a constitutional right, he was just talking to his mother, and once it came out that that was false, they just literally buried it and just went, okay, next story.
Yeah, it's, that's what really, really bothers me. Because that's the other thing, is journalism doesn't have a whole lot of integrity, I feel like, right now. At least mainstream journalism. In reference specifically, since it is popular, the PewDiePie incident, the fucking Wall Street Journal changed their headline. Like, the headline that they had originally written about him, it said, like, PewDiePie... a millionaire YouTuber is anti-Semitic, is what the original headline was. After about a day of them being fucking attacked by the internet, they change it to PewDiePie, successful YouTuber, makes anti-Semitic post. And I was like, okay. I mean, it was a step down from being anti-Semitic by saying makes an anti-Semitic post, but I still don't think that's even fair. Because, like, I mean, yeah, it's a fucked up thing to say, but, like, let's be real with each other. Like, we listen to comedians that say just as fucking bad things.
Yeah.
Like, in just different ways. I understand it is a sensitive subject because of the way history was, but, you know, like, come on. Like, if it was a bad joke, just be like, all right, that was a shitty joke. You're a bad comedian, you know?
Yeah. But plus a lot of things get taken out of context, too.
Yeah, I actually have a super funny story about anti-Semitism.
Let's see where this goes. Like, funny.
But I before you've gotten me to drop names, but this time I'm literally not going to, because it's still a band that I really like, and this was nothing more than a misunderstanding, and still to this day, it bums me out that he feels this way. Because I think this singer still feels this way about me, and it really bums me out because I love his band, and I have a tattoo of his band. So that would really like I would like if we could mend things at some point. But I made a post that said the U.S. brags so much about being the one to take care of the bullies. Why don't we tell Israel to stop bullying Palestine? And he comments and says, this is super anti-Semitic. And I was like, how? I was like, it has nothing to do with like them being Jewish. Like, it just has to do with them killing Palestinians. Like, I don't even care whose religion is what. Like,
yeah.
And he was like, whatever, dude. And then he blocked me. And then, and this was a couple of years ago, so he might have got, he probably got over it. He probably doesn't remember, but I remember because it's one of my favorite bands, so it hurt my fucking feelings. Then I hopped on Twitter and I said, hey man, you blocked me. I wanted to work this out. And he said, fuck off. And he blocked me on that. So I'd like to get to talk to him at some point and, you know, try to work things out. From what I understand, though, he isn't a super nice dude already. So, I mean, chances of me being able to talk to him and explain that to him are probably slim. But I won't name drop just in the case that I can make things better. I would definitely like to.
Okay. Now, I'll take one stab at who this is. And I kind of want you to either confirm or deny it.
if you can get it right, I'll confirm it.
Okay. Shot in the dark here, David Draymond.
No.
Okay, done. That's all I'm gonna ask because I know he's huge into like Israeli and like politics and stuff like that. Like he goes really after people that you know don't have the same views as he does about that. And like once you said that, I was like. Huh. And you're like, yeah, I have a tattoo of the band. I'm like, okay, Disturbed is very popular. This could be it. But
this, well, with me, mostly my tattoos are just of bands that have like super influenced me, even if they're not, you know, super big bands. Mm-hmm. You know, I won't list every tattoo I have because then it'll narrow down exactly who it might be. But like one of my favorites, like I have Reflections on my arm. Mm-hmm. It wasn't him. It wasn't Jake. But that's Reflections is probably one of my favorite bands of all time. So like I like to get you know bands of all sizes. Just if I like them, I like them.
Well, yeah, it's on your body. Who cares? Yeah, what
exactly.
People think? Yeah,
exactly. There's actually I actually have some tattoos of bands I don't even really listen to anymore.
Jesus.
Yeah, I don't know. Like I have a big calf piece of the Acacia Strain, and like I'll always love them, but like I don't necessarily jam them daily or anything.
Yeah,
you know.
But like that's supposed to be a symbol of like a better time or like a time of your life where you're like I really enjoy this enough to get a tattoo of it. So it's not like you know they could put out some shit music for the next three albums. You'd be like, okay, whatever. I like this one song or whatever you base it off of. Just because, you know, of that. Like, it has nothing to do with future releases. It was that one thing, that one moment of time that I just went, you know what, I like it enough to get it inked on my body, which is cool.
Yeah, I got it. Actually, it's the Wormwood album cover.
Oh, yeah, that was a solid album.
Yeah, that was my favorite album they've done so far. We'll see, man. They're talking about, you know, they're about to put out another album, so that should be really fucking sick. I'm excited to see what they come up with, especially since, you know, Amir just dropped a record.
Yeah.
I'm sure Acacia Strain is like, all right, we gotta up them on the heaviness here. The heavy breakdown record of the year, you know?
Yeah. I'm trying to forget. Trying to remember who it was. It was like some random musician, and I'm going to say it was Stephen Christian of Amberlin. Could be totally false, totally fucked up. Wrong, whatever. But I think he said that he has video of both Frankie and what's the Acacia guy's name? Oh, fuck. What was the singer of Acacia Strain?
Vincent.
Vincent, yeah. Apparently he has video of those two fighting. And apparently, really? only five people were there. It was a full-on fist fight, and he gave no other information. I think it was some interview I heard. It wasn't like directly to me, but it was like someone like that, or it could have been someone of Taken Back Sunday, like some like really random band that has nothing to do with like heaviness at all. But apparently there was a fight. There was a fist fight that went down. And there was maybe like five to like seven people that watched it or witnessed it.
Yeah, I know they had beef because they put out those two beef songs.
Yeah.
Or each one of them had a beef song.
Yeah.
About the other. But who knows, man? Who knows? I've never seen that video. I would be interested if it surfaces. You know, if you ever find it, send it to me. But
will do.
I don't know what it is. I was actually talking to my girlfriend about this earlier. I don't know what it is, my fascination of videos of, like, fights and stuff. I think they're stupid. But, like, sometimes it's like when you see, like, two real stupid people fighting each other, like, on, like, World Star Hip Hop or whatever.
Oh, don't even get me started about it.
Like, when it's like two stupid drunk dudes, it's just like, you know what? You guys deserve each other.
Yeah.
Like, I'm glad that you're both drunk enough that you want to just fight each other and no one's doing anything else.
Yeah, I think the sickest part about that website is the fight compilation things where it's like half hour long and I'm like, all right, we're going with this. And I sit there for a half hour and watch basically some dumb, you know, like, I don't want to say, it's like non-professional fighting. Like, you have the, like, the street fights, but it's, like, no punches are getting thrown, but it's, like, you know, they're, like, wrestling each other. I was, like, all right, this is kind of dumb. Or, like, you have girls, like just pulling each other's hair and just, like, you know, doing, like, the windmill thing in a mosh pit type of deal against each other. I'm, like, really? You know? There's, like,
oh,
some,
my God.
There's some sort of, like, amateurness that I like about it. Like, I also love professional fighting. Like, UFC I love. Boxing I love. There's something about, you know, who's the bigger guy? Who's the better fighter? And, you know, it's something like in our DNA that we have to have a winner for things. We have to figure out who's the strongest or who the best band is or, you know, stuff like that. But there's something about, like, something you can relate to with, like, these amateur fights that you watch online. And you're like, this could be me, but I know exactly how to defend myself in this situation if this ever occurs. But... And Mike Tyson has the greatest quote on this. And believe it or not, I actually have a signed glove by him in a frame that says, everyone has a game plan until they get punched in the mouth. And no truer words have ever been spoken in my life before.
Yeah, man. I honestly, punch me in the mouth and I won't be saying anything, man. I'm not a big dude. I'm not a big dude. Couldn't fight anybody. I would lose if I fought anybody. Honestly, I'm like 5'7" and some change, man.
Aw, you're a little guy.
Yeah, I'm a little dude, but I mean, I'm also not trying to fight anybody.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly. Yeah.
Like, if you really hate me that much, dude, like, go around. I actually encourage it. I want you to go around and tell everybody that you beat me in a fight.
Yes. Please put it up on the internet, share my videos, comment on everything. Just keep doing that. That'd be great.
I want to see how many people say that they beat me in a fight.
I think we could get that rumor started.
Dude, I could start tracking who all actually doesn't like me by who says they won in a fight. Holy cow. That'd be incredible.
That's another t-shirt.
Free Cam, and then another one that says I fought Cam.
Yeah. It's either you want him freed or you want him to stay in prison or else you're going to fight him again.
Yeah, I'm the reason he's in jail.
There we go. It's like having the same site selling the Donald Trump shirts or the Hillary Clinton shirts. You're going to get business from both angles.
Exactly. It's genius.
Yeah. There we go. God damn. We should really have you on our creative team.
Yeah, dude, it's marketing, man.
Oh, yeah, dude. Fuck yeah. Okay.
Oh, shit.
Yep. Now, we've talked for an hour and 48 minutes, and I think this is the perfect time to end things, and I am scared shitless of hitting that end button and having everything freeze. And I know you have band practice and whatnot at, what, 11 tonight?
Yeah.
Okay, so if this happens, we might have to do a quick 15-minute interview just to save our asses, but I think I have everything all set. So
let's no worries, man.
Yeah, let's hope to God that this works. And right before I let you go, obviously, you know, you're going to give us the clip of a new song. Now, what's the name of the song? Did you have that all?
The name of the song is called The Place I No Longer Visit. Mm-hmm. It's actually going to be my most personal song to date, as well as my favorite one that we've ever written. So it's kind of a double excitement thing there. But it's just kind of a song that I wrote about, you know. I did go through depression and some addiction problems to like some prescriptions and stuff, and I got through that, and that's just kind of what it's all about, is like, you know, that's all, that shit's the old me. You know, it's kind of saying like, that's even, it has a line in there that just is kind of basically saying that, like, if anyone listening to this, if you're a fan of us because of A Way Out, then you're probably not going to like our future direction, because I hate A Way Out and I hate the depression I was talking about. And that's what it's referring to when I say the place I no longer visit.
Yeah.
It's referring to, you know, my depression. It's just, I try not to get myself into that state, you know, that place of mind. So it's going to be a lot of fun. We've got a music video coming out for it next week. It's a super serious song, but the video is real party vibe, so that'll be fun. If you're a fan of anything groovy, anything fucking heavy, or anything with singing. So I just got the whole entire metal genre. Then you'll like this. This song.
All right, and some quick plugs. You are playing the So What Music Festival the second day, March 25th, Airhawk Stadium, with Mayday Parade, Attila, We the Kings, Puya, After the Burial, shit ton of awesome bands. So definitely come on out for that if you're in the area. For more information, and definitely like them on Facebook, go to facebook.com/TheHumanExperimentTX, as in short for Texas. And yeah, definitely get the new album when it comes out. Spam the shit out of that music video. Send it to all your friends, family members, strangers. It doesn't matter. It's awesome. Okay. So without further ado, I am going to hit this end button, and let's hope to God things work out. Cam, thank you so much, man.
Thank you, man. I can't wait to talk again.
Hell yeah. Later, man.